one. As you can see from that video, we tell stories. Retail is about storytelling. And there's never any one story, right? But it's about bringing the experience and inspiring people to want to engage with product. So what I want to do this morning, to that tune of there is no one story, is just give you a sense of how, over the course of a very unusual arc, I ended up being able to have the ability to work with some incredible people, both in the company and externally, to be able to tell those stories in a very immersive way. And as I said, there is no one story, and mine is unique. And you're going to hear over the next few days a lot of different stories. So take one takeaway from each that resonates with you. And by nature of that, you will be able to form a strategy and a path of what you want to do. So I think there was a little blurb in the book that said I was originally going to be a lawyer. Well, I thought that was true. So I graduated high school at 16, started college as a junior. I got engaged to be married. I was planning to be a lawyer. My fiance was going to be a doctor. So every Jewish mother's dream, right? So there I was in my last semester, going into my last semester of college. I woke up one morning and I said, this is not for me. I don't want to be a lawyer. I don't want to get married. I'm not sure what I want to do, but I know it's going to be more creative, so I'm going to move to New York and figure it out. Imagine making that phone call to your parents. But I did, and that's exactly what I did. In one fell swoop, packed my bags, ended up in New York, and said, I want to find a creative industry. And I don't know how I knew it at the time, but I knew I wanted to be in the business of making the business of creativity. So my first job was in the menswear industry. I worked for a company called Manhattan International to the president of that division, Fred Rothstein, who, by the way, is now 82, and I've had lunch with him over the course of my career at least every other year. But interestingly enough, I only worked there for about 11 months because I realized at that point, it was 1977, that a woman wasn't really going to be going anywhere in that company. And I maybe needed to go somewhere else that was smaller and more intimate so I could learn the industry and get a lot of exposure in a more intimate way. And I think that so many people think that the next step has to be bigger. It doesn't always have to be bigger. It needs to give you an experience that's going to allow you to become more broad. So I went to work for a designer at the time named Jeffrey Banks. And he was a menswear designer, more high-end, but with a company that was maybe not as high-end. But he gave me every opportunity. I learned sales. I learned merchandising, production, PR. It was a few-person company within a company. And I got exposure, and I think about today, the number of people who are now CEOs of retail that I met when they were DMMs or in a buying office. So it was the start of really creating relationships. Well, they decided not to continue with that division. So I ended up going into other businesses in menswear. But I stayed very close to Jeffrey. And what happened? A few years later, he called me and said, I'm joining as creative director of this incredible company called Merona Sport. You've got to come and work with me. And I did. And that became one of the hottest companies of the 80s. And it goes back to, across your career, build those relationships. You're going to need them. And build your reputation, because you're going to need that. And when I think about it, when I got to HSN, and I'll get to that, those relationships and that reputation I had built is what made me be able to have the confidence that I could take a risk and be able to turn around the company. So then they launched Jeffrey Banks, which was his collection. And if you I think back now, I worked with some incredible people. So at Jeffrey Banks Menswear, Isaac Mizrahi was a women's designer. John Varvatos was the Midwest sales rep that I hired. Okay, Ed Medikeski, who's now, you know, Kevin O'Malley. I mean, we had an incredible group of people. And so go where the energy is. Go where the people are. And go what's the next. Take that risk of new. And that's going to be a theme that you're going to hear throughout this. Risk-taking and boldness is basically the essence of transformation, whether it's about yourself or whether it's about a company. I then had the opportunity to work for an incredible designer in the late 80s named Willie Smith. Willie was the first African-American designer to really believe, and this was before Target democratized fashion, that fashion came from the street up, not necessarily couture down. First designer to do a fashion show at the Puck Building. Instead of a fashion show, he did a movie with the director Max Vatical on the Senegalese National Ballet shot in Senegal. And he also was the first designer to believe that partnerships with art, culture, and entertainment would create excitement. So designers like Keith Haring and Barbara Kruger. And I had the opportunity to experience all that, as well as experience his love of India, where we did a lot of our manufacturing, and have so many different opportunities to speak with people outside the typical industry. And that was another significant learning. Get outside yourself. If you're in a beauty division, don't just stay in beauty. I just came from the Consumer Electronics Show, the melding of technology and fashion and home and health. So expose yourself to the broadest array of experiences that you could possibly have. Unfortunately, Willie was one of the first casualties of AIDS. And unfortunately, the company really couldn't sustain itself beyond that. And I had the opportunity to work for an incredible gentleman named Tommy Hilfiger when that company was about $38 million and had an incredible, incredible, you know, ride for about 3 years. And then I got a phone call. There's this company, Warnico, that wants you to be president of Chaps Ralph Lauren. I said, are you crazy? I'm with the hottest company in the entire menswear industry. Why would I leave right now? And they said, well, you know, the business is an opportunity. You can be president and CEO. There weren't very many women presidents in the menswear industry. And you'd be working with Ralph Lauren. Would you just go meet Ralph? I said, okay. So I go meet Ralph, and at the time, Peter Strom. And if you've ever met Ralph, he's quite convincing and relatively hard to say no to. And we had this conversation, and he goes, look, I need this business to be something. I know you can do it. Would you take this? And I said, you know what? I do think I could do it. And I accepted the job. But when it was announced that I was leaving to go do this, everybody thought I was insane because I was leaving, truly, what was the hottest company in the business, to go to a company that wasn't doing well in a relatively controversial company, but I knew I could do it. And it was a time when I was ready to take a risk. And there weren't going to be other opportunities like this. And I felt I'd also be working with the Ralph Lauren organization. So I jumped right in, and it was a very exciting time. We took the company from about $28 million to $250 million in 3 years. We created a category of main floor men's collections. I built this incredible team, and it really was a great experience and a great learning experience. And it was also my first experience with the public markets and having to meet with investors and things like that. However, 3 years later, I realized something was wrong. The culture and the values of the company did not align with mine. So it didn't matter how well I was being treated or how successful I was. This wasn't somewhere where I felt that I could stand up and be proud that I was. So I came home one night. I said to my husband, I'm resigning the next day. I had a four-year-old child. I needed to work. I wasn't independently wealthy. But I said, I know this is the right thing to do, and it's going to be okay. And I came in the next morning, and I resigned. And the person I resigned to said, you're either independently wealthy, you have another job, or you're stupid. And I said, or D, none of the above. And I was escorted out by security. There I was, standing on Park Avenue and 38th, going, what did I do? But I knew I did the right thing. And a day later, Ralph and Peter called me and said, we're sorry you left, because it was a licensee, but if you're going to work anywhere else, excuse me, we want you to work here. And with that, I worked at in corporate for a year, working on the business plan for Polo Jeans, which they then asked me to start up and run, which I did for 4 years. Started a company from scratch, built it to $450 million. It got acquired by Jones New York. And it was incredibly exciting to truly birth something and to be able to build an organization. But I knew that there was a next chapter. I knew that I really had to become more of a marketing professional. I knew that the world was going global. So what could be next? And I had the incredible opportunity to work for Phil Knight at Nike for 6 years running their global apparel business. And if you know anything about Phil, the one thing you will take away, you will get an MBA in marketing, but more important, you will learn the power of culture and the power of integrity and the power of being able to make a brand relevant by having such strong guardrails, Ralph being the same thing. So I had an incredible 6 years, but I was traveling around the world. I was actually commuting between New York and Portland. My last year, I was in China every 6 weeks, and I knew that something had to change. And I left Nike. Everybody thought, what's she gonna do? What's she gonna do? And when it was announced that I decided to go to Barry Diller's company at the time, IAC, people thought I'd had a midlife crisis. And it was very strategic, though, and this is what I tell people. I knew the world was changing. I wanted direct-to-consumer. I wanted a brand that could be an experience. I wanted to be able to tell stories directly to the customer. And this was an opportunity to have this incredible platform, this incredible vehicle that today could be ignited by technology to tell stories across our catalog platforms, et cetera. However, HSN was not what it is today. And it was a risk. It was a business I was not familiar with. I didn't know TV. I didn't know a lot of the categories of business. I wasn't an expert in digital. But I knew that there was a vision. So if you have a vision, don't let anyone take that vision away because they don't see what you see today. If you believe in it and you see what that path is, you just need to be able to evangelize and inspire and take people along that vision. And so I made the move and was able to start the process of reinventing the business. But the first thing I had to do was reinvent the culture. And that's what we did. We said, here's the vision, here's the brand, here's where we're going. Now, you're either on that car or you're not. And we had incredible people. Too many people think if a company is doing well, the people aren't good. No, it's the leadership that's not good. You have to inspire people and give them an idea of how they can be invested in that success. So Bill Brand, who you're going to hear from later, who's now the president of HSN, was the first person I hired on this journey. And it's actually been a journey together. And then in 2008, we were able to take the company public just as the world fell apart. It was the biggest leadership moment for me because I knew that we were going to be successful. That was happening externally was no fault, or we had control. So we had to prove that our business was going to be resilient in this marketplace. And we were able to do that. We actually grew in 2008 and 2009 and proved the resiliency of our team and our business model. And today, when I look at where we are as a company, from 2008 to 2014, our market cap is 10 times greater, from $400 million to $4 billion. And it's because we've never deviated from that strategy and from that mission. So where's the future? We feel that retail today is the most exciting industry you can be in. It's part technology, it's part media, it's part entertainment, it's commerce, it's consumerism, it's all connected in what we call boundaryless retail. And I think you are at the most exciting point right now because it's changing, it's incredibly dynamic. And if I was going to leave you with three things, and clearly you can tell I did not have one path to my career. There is no one path. And you have to look at it as a series of moves. It's not always upward. It's sideways. And sometimes it may be backwards. But there's three things that I live by in terms of my mantra. Number one, am I passionate about it? Do I wake up every morning and get excited about what the possibilities can be? Can I evangelize it? Number two, is it purposeful? There are some other things I'm passionate about, but I can assure you it won't pay my rent, right? Is it purposeful? Is it taking me somewhere? And then the third, will I have impact? And impact is going to change depending on where you are in your life and your career. The most important thing, no matter what job you're in, is focus on making other people successful. Don't focus on your next step. Because if you make other people successful, they'll be invested in your success, and you will have impact on whatever organization you're with. But today, 37 years later, yes, I still want to have impact on my business. But as Sandy mentioned, HSN Cares has become very important to me. The NRF Foundation has become very important to me, because now my impact is bigger than just my career or the company itself. My impact can be on, you know, people. My impact can be on the world. My impact can be on creating opportunity. So those are kind of, that's my story. Those are my takeaways, and I just wanted to share them with you. So thank you. So I'd love to take any questions, any thoughts that people may have. Oh, come on, this is not a shy group.
Good morning. Oh.
The fact that at least once a day I say you can't make this stuff up. So let me say what that means. You know, I think curiosity in today's world is one of the most important things you can have. The intellectual curiosity to always want to be learning. And I always say, I always want to be learning. And then the second thing is the people. I love the people I work with. They inspire me. I surround myself with people who are not like myself. I think diversity is very important. Diversity of thought and being able to have incredible dialogue and challenges, and those are the things that really inspire me.
Hi, good morning. Christine Fraser from FIT. Your story is very inspirational. What advice can you give to those of us that are changing careers, and how can we look forward starting a new career in retail?
Well, first of all, kudos to you for making a decision to make a change if you felt that that was the right thing to do. I think that's the hardest part for a lot of people. They just keep going, right? I think what I would say is immerse yourself as much as possible in a lot of different things to find those couple of things that all of a sudden you have an aha moment and go, this is where I want to go. This is what excites me. Network. Network, network, network. And then the third thing, even if you're already in a role, get outside your role. So I always tell people, if somebody asks you to be on a project team, your hand should go up first. Because if you want to get ahead, having people see you in leadership positions, even outside your current role, is very important, because then when something comes up, they'll think of you.
Hello, my name is Lewis McDermott from Georgia Southern University. I had a question today about what's one of the things that you see in seniors today graduating from college that you think they most need to improve on to succeed in the retail industry?
So I would say I think there's a lot of talent coming out of schools today. But again, I would go back to, you know, my premise is, stop thinking right now about what you want to be in 10 years, right? I think too many people want to go from here to here, and they've got a path, and they've got linear. You got to live in I am going to be the best at what I can do. I can learn as much as I can, and I'm going to focus on doing a great job and making other people successful, and then I will move forward. I think too many people are thinking about the next step before they've even done that first step. And it's really important, because what you think the next 10 years are going to be today are probably going to be dramatically different. So why focus on that anyway? Disruptive technologies can change what you're doing. I'm sure somebody in retail 20 years ago never envisioned that they'd be running a digital company, right? So do the best you can do, make other people successful, have an impact on your organization, and that's going to move you ahead, not because you want to go ahead.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Sydney from Indiana University.
Hi.
What was it in your life that made you see that creativity was going to be necessary to make you happy in your career?
You know, I was always creative when I was younger. I loved to paint, I loved to draw, I loved to build. I loved to do all these things. And as a matter of fact, very, very early on, I contemplated going into more of a fine arts career until I got to school and I started taking classes and realized that there were a hell of a lot of people much more talented than I was. But I loved it. So I said, if I could take my love of all things creative and you know, all things interfacing with brands and products, like everyone who knows me knows, I get as excited going into like a CVS as I do Bergdorf Goodman, right? It's just the experience. So, but if I could take that and channel it into a business framework, that means I'll understand creative people. And I've worked with designers, I work with talent and celebrities and inventors, and I feel that I understand them in such a way that I can channel that and apply it to a business approach.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm relatively I'm a voracious reader, I'm a voracious shopper, right? So we do a couple of things internally that's been very helpful. We actually identified people within the organization, in digital, in mobile, in others, that put out a weekly, let's call it blog, of all the interesting articles that might be there. I use that as a resource. I get the same thing weekly from YouTube, for example. I'm out at a lot of conferences. I read across every single possible, you know, I'm still a person that actually likes a physical magazine because I like to rip. And I read everything from Bloomberg Business Week to Wired to Fast Company. I'm out there. I also read a lot of business books. So I'm reading a book right now called Crazy as a Compliment. So about how entrepreneurism and thinking. So it really is casting a very wide net, but also to tap into people that can consolidate for you and be able to digest as much as possible in a short time.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, everyone. It's great to be here, and I know you're going to have a great couple of days.